The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Welcome to the July 2020 CCAST. Today's presentation is CICA 2020 R1 Standards Release, Enhanced Quality Assurance Tools and Processes. I'm Paul Berry, Executive Director of CICA. The Collision Industry Electronic Commerce Association, or CICA, develops and promotes electronic communication standards that allow the collision industry to be more efficient. We also provide webinars like this one to help educate both members and non-members. Today's presenter, Andy Bober, will be discussing CICA's 2020 R1 standards release, including its new automated build process created for the publication of CICA standards. Andy is a software engineer at Integral. He has over 20 years of experience in information technology. His specialties and skills include software development, SDLC, team development, mentoring, technical architecture, JSON schema, Node.js, Java, Java EE, and web services. Over the course of his career, Andy has been a software analyst lead, data and application development manager, technical lead, developer, and systems analyst. Today, Andy will share the latest developments of CICA standards, including a significant improvement in the build process. As we start the webinar, I want to remind you there is no verbal communication between the participants and the presenter. If you have questions during the webinar, please type them in a webinar navigation pane on your screen. We'll answer as many questions as possible at the end of the presentation. And now I turn the presentation over to Andy.
Thank you, Paul, for that nice introduction. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining me today for this discussion about the 2020 R1 release of CICA's Business Message Suite. This is an unusual release in that there are no functional changes. That means there are no new messages, no new aggregates, no new codes or code types or any of those details. So what is new? First, we've combined the classic code and the code extension schemas. Later on, I'll talk about how to switch back and forth between the two. Second, the processes and procedures we are using to maintain the XML schema have changed. First, we've moved the release to GitHub. So in prior to this, the releases were stored on local workstations and on box.com, and there wasn't really good access to them from the rest of the architecture team. There was kind of one maintainer who was elected to do the maintenance, and it wasn't easy to share the code. So now that they're moved to GitHub, that sharing challenge has been eliminated. And as you'll see, we've also added some processes and procedures to enhance the quality as well. Second, a database has been introduced to house the codes used in the build process. We'll talk about that a little bit later as well, but that had to be done because the build process, the automated build process, runs on GitHub. And because of that, we can't really run macros in Microsoft Excel. And we do use macros, as we'll see, to generate the code validation schemas, so, or at least we used to. So anyway, so to be able to migrate that off of Microsoft Excel and onto the servers at GitHub, we had to have the information in a database that could be accessed by the build process. And lastly, a automated build and test process has been created. So this means that the schema itself is stored as a templated version of itself, and we maintain that templated version, and then we run the build process to actually build the final version of it. And when I say template, I don't mean anything scary like some sort of new language or an actual templating. All it is we've removed all versions and normalize the file names and things like that, so that all that can be injected during the build process. Okay, Next slide. So what is not changing? You can still download the BMS standard from Sika.com. It will still include the spreadsheet of codes we're all familiar with, the BMS Microsoft Word document that describes all the messages, aggregates, and optional components is still there. It will still contain the recently added XML test instances. And it will continue to follow the familiar naming convention that uses year, release, number, and version. Lastly, you will still be able to use either the code extension variant or the classic code variant of the XML schemas. So what specifically is changing then? As I mentioned earlier, one of the biggest changes this release is combining the schema variants into one unified XML schema with the option of switching between them. As we'll see, this eliminates duplicate files in the XML schema and reduces the demand on the maintainers of this industry standard. A database has been introduced to facilitate the build process on github.com. And as I said before, this is needed because the system of record for Sika codes is a very large Microsoft Excel spreadsheet we call the master code list. The spreadsheet has long-standing macros that were traditionally used to generate the code validation schemas. Now, rather than generate those code validation schemas using the macros, we are using different macros to export the entire database to an SQLite database. And this database is used by the build process to then generate the validation schemas when it's run on GitHub or when it's run on the maintainer's local workstations. And as I mentioned, the other change is the automated build process that's been created that runs automatically when changes are pushed to GitHub. Similarly, there's an automated testing process that's been created that also runs when changes are pushed to GitHub. As we'll see when we go over the new processes, this additional validation enhances the overall quality of the release Sika produces twice a year. So what was wrong with the old process? Why did we need to make a change? As we'll see, the old process was heavily focused on one individual making many changes without much assistance in verifying the changes. We've seen occasions where version numbers were not updated or contained typos. We've also seen that the solution was brittle. A small mistake in all the boilerplate changes could cause validation to fail, and the issue wouldn't be discovered until after making all the boilerplate changes. You'd have to go back and try and figure out which one had a typo in it. As we'll see, the new process addresses this by facilitating quick testing on demand as changes are being made to the standard. So the old schema organization, previously, the schema was organized into two separate deliverables. There were actually two schemas available, the code extension schemas and the classic code schemas. Unfortunately for the maintainers, there was 96% duplication in the files between these two deliverables. The code extension variant contained 51 individual XML files, and the classic code variant contained 50 schema files. The only real difference between these two variants was the way codes were validated. The classic code schema would only validate, and it still does, only validates basic string-like restrictions, whereas the code extension schema validates specific code values. Lastly, for this slide, the codes were stored along with the other schema files. And as we'll see, in the new schema organization, that's not the case. The codes are left in the spreadsheet and are as well in the database that's generated. Okay, the new schema organization. The new schema organization eliminates the duplicate files by combining the schemas, as I mentioned earlier. There are just two code schema files that differentiate between classic code and code extension schemas. Also, the individual file names have been updated to reflect the common schema. File names no longer include the variant, such as code EXT or classic code. So in the example file name that we're looking at here, notice on the first column, it says BMS root. And I won't try going back, but on the prior slide, it actually listed the variant in there. So now it's simplified to just have the file name and then the usual version, release, and year information. And as I mentioned, the codes are not stored on github.com. They're as files. They remain in the database and also in the master code list. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the two processes. We're going to compare and contrast the old process with the new process. And I wasn't able to include every single step in here, but generally, I think the message is gonna be clear that we're enhancing the quality basically by running more tests and having more people involved in it. So as I had mentioned previously, we more or less had one person who was elected or they volunteered to be the maintainer of the code, and they would actually be the physical keys on keyboard or hands on keyboard making changes to the schema that were all approved by the various committees and the architecture, including the architecture committee. But only one person would actually type those things in. So the first thing that maintainer would do is make a copy of the prior release, and then they would have to go through 101 individual files and by hand change the schema tags. The schema tags would include some information such as version and other details, but it's 101 individual files that had to be updated. And that was really just boilerplate information, the version number. And likewise, there's 101 corresponding include tags that would have to be updated because the file names were changing. And so that same person would have to go through and update each one of these include tags. And any mistake in one of those include tags would cause the validation to fail. And there's an app info, the fourth item in there is the app info tag. So that had to be kept in sync with the version number and the schema tags. And there's a build number that's in there as well. So once the maintainer made it through all that boilerplate work, then they could start on the actual business changes. And so they would go through, make the changes that were being requested by the various committees. And then we had a tool called the BAT tool. We still do. And that BAT tool would be used to validate all the changes at that time. And then I've got that feeding back into the business changes. So as Charlie or any one of the other folks that would maintain the schema would make changes, they would be able to run that tool. But the challenge there with that tool is that it has to have individual entries in each file to make sure that the schemas are related back to each other. And so there's some other opportunities with that particular tool. But the primary message that I'm trying to get across here is that the old process had all this boilerplate work that had to be done, and then we could get into the actual business changes. And then once the business changes were made, there we will go through a QA meeting, a face-to-face QA meeting. And at that meeting, we would again run the BAT tool, validate the schemas, and talk about various topics related to how we want to maintain the schemas moving forward, or if there's any best practices or whatnot. And but there may be changes. So there may be something that doesn't validate correctly at the face-to-face, or there may be a best practice that wasn't followed, et cetera. And so that's why the arrow goes back up to the maintainer so that they can make any additional changes. So, and that would happen after the QA meeting. So after the face-to-face meeting ends, everyone goes back to their hometowns, and the QA changes would be made. And then a revalidation would happen, and then we get published out to the website. And again, the challenge here is that there's just one person, the maintainer. The maintainer would go back and make those changes. Nobody would ever peer review. There wasn't any processes there to help the maintainer, you know, to make sure that there weren't any typos or any other unfortunate mistakes that were added. So based on that, you know, we came up with the new process. So hit the new process. So now this diagram looks complicated. It looks like it's actually more complicated than the other one. But I just want to point out that that really what's happening is there's many more instances of validation that's happening. And so in the upper left-hand corner, again, rather than starting with making a copy and making all those boilerplate changes, you just start making, you download it from GitHub, you start making the business changes that are needed, and you run a build. When you run the build will also include a validation of the schema, and you can go back to making more business changes. So if the maintainer has worked with four or five individual groups and has, say, four or five distinct changes that need to be made to, say, five different messages, then you can go message by message and systematically make your business change, run the build, have the automated validation validate that everything is right. And if it isn't right, you immediately go back to that one message, and you're able to continue working on it until it passes validation. And then if you choose to, well, kind of the best practice would be to go ahead and commit that small change back to GitHub. And you could see the first arrow going down there to the GitHub swim lane, and an updated schema gets pushed up at that time. And again, a validation, a build and validation routine is run on github.com. It's the exact same build and validation routine that is run on the maintainer's desktop, actually. So they're kept completely in sync, but of course the difference is it's running on GitHub and there's a track record of it. When the maintainer up on the top swim lane is making changes and runs the validation, there's no audit trail of that. You can run it as many times as you want, and you're not going to have to worry about, you know, how many times you're running it or anything. But on GitHub, every validation, as we'll see, every time a change is pushed, the validation, the build and validation routine runs, and it's recorded. And if it happens to be a release, then you also get a release created, a release zip file that has the actual deliverable schema to be released. So as I was saying, if you were working with, say, five messages, you'd be up in that upper left-hand corner and you'd be working in that circle, make business changes, run a build, do a validate, push those changes to GitHub. And you'd work your way through the five messages. And in the previous slide, you had validation that was happening, but it wasn't really enforced, and it wasn't audited, wasn't auditable. It was something that somebody did on their workstation, and you didn't get to see it in any sort of a log. So after the maintainer would get done in the new process, when we get done with the five messages, we'd end up going to the face-to-face QA meeting, where we have the same scenario. Basically, we get to sit down, have a face-to-face, talk about the changes, make sure everything still validates, And again, we can have some changes that would come out of there. Now, the difference here is that once the meeting is over with and everybody kind of goes back to the to their hometown, we can still all collaborate on GitHub. And we can decide when to create the release and when not to create the release. And if we do, creating the release is an actual commit up to GitHub. And it there's a flag that will indicate to GitHub to not just do a regular validation, do the validation, but also generate a release. And so at that point, you've got a auditable release that's been created. And as we'll see in a few slides upcoming, that the file that's generated is able to be downloaded. It's up there in GitHub. It is the final schema that is the actual Sika BMS schema, but it's not accessible to everyone there. So as I said in the original slide, the schema will be put up on GitHub, on Sika.com to be consumed by the Sika population. And so there's two points I'd like to make about this slide. There's definitely some areas for improvement. And one of them, the first one, you might notice that at the very last step that the maintainer does is actually publish out to the website. And the arrow goes from the create release step down to the website, where really that arrow should start from the third swim lane down, from github.com. So that release that was created, it should automatically be published to the website to kind of remove that last manual push out to the website, because somebody may grab the wrong files, or again, the idea is to enhance the quality, remove any manual steps where mistakes could be made, and automate everything. That's the best way that we know of to enhance the quality. So that's one thing that could be done differently, and hopefully we can work that out in the future. The other thing that could be done actually is in that second swim lane, the architecture team, during the QA meeting. I didn't put it on there, but one of the things that's done there is a spell check of the BMS, and that's not baked into this automated build process, but that could be. So that's another opportunity we have for improvement. So summarize the benefits of the new process. It eliminates all the manual boilerplate work, as we talked about. But really, the main thing is that it puts the focus on the business messages and the codes rather than all the boilerplate work. It removes the tedious type of work and lets the people focus on what's really important, which is, of course, the new messages. New messages, codes, aggregates, all that. And of course, it promotes higher quality through the automated testing that's implemented. And I didn't list it, but it's also more auditable. So the build process, the actual build process is written in Node and JavaScript. And I think I also mentioned that there's a macro that has to be run in the master code list spreadsheet to generate the database. So I'd like to go over these three build commands that we have that are part of the build process. These commands are available to the architecture team members when working on new releases. And if you could think back to that slide that we just went over, these are the commands that they would be running to run the build, run a test, or to do any one-off type validations. So in the first column here, is the build command, the npm run build. This command generates the code validation schemas from the SQLite database we talked about earlier. It generates the final release XML schema, and it resolves all those include tags within each file to reference the appropriately named file. As I mentioned before, this resolving is required because each file's file name has been normalized as it was added to GitHub. So The files don't contain version number or release information as they sit in GitHub. This only comes from the build. This information is added by the npm run build command. Also, the 101 boilerplate changes from the old process have been reduced and eliminated. So success, no more manual changes as far as the boilerplate changes go. So that was that first one, the npm run build command. Now the next one is the validation, npm test. This command validates all the test instances that are stored with the release. There are currently 421 test instances. This is very useful because it can be run on demand on maintainers' workstations, as well as being run automatically when the changes are pushed up to GitHub. So again, the theme here is to inject more quality, do more validation, and have it run in an automated way when possible. And the last command here, the npm run validate command, this is really a utility command that is only intended to be run on maintainers' workstations. It allows one-off validation of a test instance file that may be in the process of being created or modified. And rather than having to add it out to the general population of the test instances, and the test does run relatively quick to validate all 421 instances, but it would be a lot faster to just do one as you're working on it. So it's less intrusive, and also, again, just puts us in the right direction towards enhancing quality. So the rest of this presentation is going to go over what those commands look like when it's run, when they're run, as well as what you would see on GitHub if you're one of the architecture team members with access to it. So here is that first command, the npm run build command. And you can see I ran it there at the top where it says npm run build at the first command prompt. And it spits out a little bit of information here. It talks about how it initializes the directories. And you can see it's generating the code schemas, as I mentioned. It's resolving the includes. And then it tells you where exactly the release is ready on your file system. And now once that file system is updated with the release, then a maintainer can open it up in their favorite editor and or validation tool and further do work on to verify that it's as expected. So many of the maintainers choose to use something like XML Spy or the Oxygen XML editor, and so you wouldn't want to open up those templated versions and try and validate with those. You would open up this particular, the actual release that gets generated and then go on from there. So that's the npm run build command. Now the npm test command, this is a run of it showing that it discovered 421 test instances that needed to be validated. It kind of reports out what schema it's using, where it's looking for those test instances. You could see it's looking in dot dot XML test instances directory for all XML files in there. So that way the maintainers can just throw any new ones in there or delete any that don't make sense anymore. And it'll automatically be picked up. Now this little report here, it reports out what's valid, how many are valid, how many are invalid, and how many caused errors. So it's possible that a file may be valid, but for some reason the tool can't validate it for some reason. In fact, it just errors out. So in that case, it has the ability to at least report on how many times that happened. And it would also include, the file that caused it. And then we have a skipped component because we had a couple of test instances that had several hundred thousand lines of XML that were just taking a really, really long time, and it didn't really seem to make sense to include that type of volume in one file to be tested just in testing the XML schema itself. That's more of a kind of a live production volume type test, as opposed to just verifying that individual messages can be validated. Lastly, it reports out how long it took. Here, when I ran it this morning, it took just about 35 seconds to validate all those things. And that will vary on the computer being used, of course. But the thing to take away here is that there's 421 test instances, and that the test instances can be added or removed at any time. And it'll automatically pick it up. No code changes or anything like that are needed. So this is that third command, the npm run validate command, and it shows an error. So I took one of the other XML instances, I moved it to a different folder, and I edited it to introduce an error. And as you can see, it says down there, I think it's about 5 or 6 lines down, next to info, it says it found an invalid test instance. It reports the one that it found, and it gives you the error. It says that particular document info element was not expected. So when something like this happens, it would be up to the maintainer to then go open up the file, look at it, and figure out what was wrong, why wasn't that expected? And in this case, it's because I had deleted a few of the elements before that one. So it wasn't expecting to see that one, it was expecting to see the elements that I had deleted. In fact, it actually says that right here. It says expected is the RQUID. So that type of information will help maintainers be able to quickly determine the issues and how to resolve them. Okay, so moving on to how those tests are done and run on GitHub. So here I'm logged on to my account, and we're looking at the Sika BMS schemas project. And you could see I'm on the actions tab, and on the left-hand side, the highlighted option there is the build and test option. So the list that we're looking at here is the recent times code had been committed and who did the committing, and also what change was made. So this is that audit log I was talking about, how when somebody makes a change, you get to see who made the change, you get to see the comments that they added, what change did they make and why did they do it. And I can't demonstrate right here because it's just a slide, but you would be able to drill down into this change and see each individual line, what exactly was changed by the person. And you could see those top three ones, those were all me, and Mike Hastings made the one at the bottom there. And that was actually a good test, because I had made changes, I submitted a pull request, and we had another architecture team member validate and approve the test. So again, rather than relying on just one person to make all the changes, we have two people involved, checks and balances, more eyes on it, and increasing the quality. So the next slide here is very similar. It's just drilling down into the log that's there. And you could see here the various steps that it runs. It's gonna do some setup work. It actually, if you're familiar with Kubernetes, what's happening is it's spinning up a pod out in the cloud. It checks out the code, it installs Node, and eventually it runs that same build process that we talked about earlier. It runs that exact same command, then it runs npm test to validate everything. And if there are no validation errors, then, and there was no errors with the installation process, then it's deemed a success. So here you can see you've got the little green check marks next to everything. This particular build was a success. Moving on to releases. So when a release is created, it's just a little bit different than a regular build and test. it runs those same steps. It does the same build command. It runs the same validation command, but there's an extra step in there to actually zip up the schema that was produced and make it available on the website here. And I had mentioned that earlier. So on the next slide, we're gonna see that. But so when this happened, on this particular one, you could see that it was pushed by Project Zika. I'm pretty sure that's Charlie. And so what we did there was we had to tag the commit and the push specifically such that GitHub would know that this is an actual release. It's not just a normal one, it's a release. And it goes through this create release route. And you can see I've got it circled there, the particular release. That's the current release that's out there on Zika.com right now. So this is another section of the website. And you're able to look through the various releases that have been created. Currently, there's only one release that's been created and released by Zika using the new process. It's this one, version 6.1. And you can see I have it highlighted there, the actual zip file that was generated. And again, the idea here is that that zip file, it contains the final release, but it's not available to the general Zika population via this website. The maintainer will package it up and put it out on Zika.com to be consumed and made available to the general population. So I should say membership, excuse me. So that basically covers everything that I wanted to say today. Thank you very much for attending. And if you guys have any questions, I'd be happy to try and answer them.
All right, thank you, Andy. Now, that was really good information. You and the rest of the team have done a great job improving that process. Stacy Phillips, Zika's marketing director, has been monitoring the webinar for questions. Stacy, have we received any questions from the attendees?
Yes, thanks, Paul. Andy, we have a question about where things stand in regards to JSON, and will it follow the same process?
So where things stand to JSON, with the JSON schema, the existing schema has been converted to JSON schema. And what we don't have is 100% of all of our 421 test instances validating. And we really, I think, are looking for help, to be honest, because we have a tool that will convert those instances into XML instances. Excuse me, the other way around. They convert the XML instances into JSON instances, but that conversion can go south, or it might not be perfect every time, frankly. So really what we need is somebody to go through all 400 and at least the ones that are not passing, and try and figure out what's the problem. And it's almost always, every time that we've looked at it so far, it's had to do with values not being converted as expected in these test instances, as opposed to a problem with the schema itself. So that's kind of the state of affairs with that. And to answer the other part of that question, yes, it will. It doesn't at the moment, but yes, it will be automated just like this. We would hopefully be able to add we already have tools that generate the schema from the XML schema, and that could easily be tied into this build process. And I anticipate that we will do that in the future. And it's a good, timely question, actually, because even though that effort has been going on for so long, the actual JSON schema specification has been lagging until recently. Until very recently, actually, with the most recent release of JSON schema, it's been included now, or the OpenAPI specification has announced that they're going to start including the full JSON schema specification. Now, in the past, the OpenAPI spec it used what they called a superset of it. And so they had several enhancements and things. And anyway, so that's going away. And now they are going to fully support the full JSON schema. And that's going to start as soon as version 3.1 of OpenAPI is released. I don't actually know when that is, but that's the latest news that I know of.
Thank you, Andy. We also have a question about GitHub access and if it's accessible to SQL members.
So GitHub is not going to be made available, to the best of my understanding, to all SQL members. It will be made available to people who are going to be on the architecture committee to some level. I'm not sure exactly how many accounts that that Sika has, but I assume if there was enough interested people that they would create as many accounts as needed. Hopefully, within reason. I'm sure we can't have thousands of people on the committee, but yeah, we would love to have more people.
Thank you, Andy. It looks like that's all the questions for now.
Okay, great. Well, thank you, Stacy and Andy, both. Very good information. Please don't forget to check Sika.com for a full schedule of future broadcasts and to watch recordings of past webinars. Links are available under the CCAST tab at the top of the page. This presentation today will be made available by this afternoon or tomorrow. Sika has partnered with the Automotive Management Institute. Attendees of this webinar are eligible to receive credit toward a professional designation from AMI after taking a short quiz on its website. A link will be sent to all attendees. Please follow Sika's social media platforms to stay up to date on following on upcoming events and the Sika news. And with that, this concludes today's webinar. Thank you very much for attending.